I am the CEO of a company called Vastari, and we are working on a microservices app that works within the art and culture industry. Specifically, our 11-person team in London is managing matchmaking between high net worth individuals who own art and museums who are planning exhibitions that want to borrow that art. So basically, you have to authenticate the users in terms of, do they really work at that museum? But what this presentation is going to mainly talk about is the way that we are trying to authenticate the art that's on our platform, that it really is what it says it is, and that we can then use that information. And I completely agree with the previous presentation that security is in distribution. So we're not a centralized authority on this entire thing. I'm going to be talking more about the landscape and how we are working with other partners and other providers to authenticate these things. So I guess starting out, what is art? Art is really an object. It could be a Neanderthal flint rock from 35,000 years ago that showed that humans cared about lines, to something that tells a story about a massive tragedy that people want to remember, to a painting that has a technique from the 17th century that really people are fascinated by, to something that sold for $450 million last year. So these things are all objects that we can possess, but their value is really in the stories behind the art. So these, in retrospect, if we want to authenticate these objects, it's about, I guess in our terms, the metadata that exists about that object. And so for all of the retrospective databases that we are managing, we're looking at that information that's attached to that object to then be able to authenticate it. But art is also changing. We are now going into a completely different type of art going forward. We have interactive infinity rooms by Yayoi Kusama, where you feel like it's never ending. This is not a flat painting. This is something that's immersive. It's mainly also has a huge identity on Instagram. What does that mean for us as connectors? Then you also have art like CryptoKitties, which sells for $140,000 at auction, has blockchain records attached to it. So you can maybe use those records to authenticate the art as well. And lastly, this is another blockchain example. These are PowerDada. They have artists from around the world working together on a work of art, and then they can save that, encrypt that information about that work of art and make it unique and immutable so that they can then sell it. So we're really looking at three different types of data that we're working with today. In the retrospective databases, we mainly have an artwork that comes with a PDF or a Word document or an Excel, and if we're lucky, a JSON, with information about the artwork. And then you want information about the owner of that artwork. In our case, a lot of times the owner wants to maintain anonymity. So there are other ways that we work with that anonymity. I'm going to look mainly at, that anonymous owner could also own different artworks that have different types of records, records that are digital or records that are blockchain enabled. So if we're looking at these three different types of records, it's really interesting to start thinking about, okay, how do we mine the data from those three different types of records in a way that's consistent so that we can build that chain, and how do we authenticate these works of art? And really, we're still at the early stages. We're still starting with all of these different data sources and trying to figure out, okay, how do we find commonalities between the information that's out there and how do we work with that? There are three main things that we are looking at, which is three main techniques that we have been working with to make this possible, and those are the three things that I'll be focusing on today. So the first is standard language, having a lot of vocabularies and APIs that you can plug into that help define protocols amongst the industry. The second is identifying trusted data sources, and the third is the challenge of connecting these digital assets to physical artworks. So an artwork usually comes with standard information about it. So it has some information about the size, the vitals. So is it an oil on canvas? Is it an installation? Then you've got information about the authenticity. Is it signed? Does it have a document or a certificate? Does it have some documentation on the title, like a contract? And then you have what you could call the supply chain. Does it? What's the provenance information? Who owns it now and who owned it in the past? Where has it been exhibited before in the past? And where has it been mentioned in books before in the past? So this is industry standard within the art world. And what we do is we look at these records. This is an example of one of the artworks we were looking at. And we look at that standard language from the art historical background of how you show a work of art. And then we analyze where does that data come from and how could we identify the sources of those data. And then what vocabularies could we use to help authenticate that information. So in the case of the artist that creates the work, there's an amazing standard language vocabulary managed by Getty that has all of the information about all of the artists. And not only is it every single artist, but it has the alternative names in different languages. So we actually created a search index using the information from Getty that that helps us with our autocomplete for our so that we don't get duplicate records. We sync back to Getty so that they can have the information about new artists we've identified that need to be part of that vocabulary. So I guess if you're looking at other industries, who are these people that hold indexes that you can collaborate with and create APIs that can work together? Deduplication is extremely important because then you can really make sure that your search also helps identify potential issues with the data. And then there's a bit of a difference between the vocabularies that are available publicly, so these are open APIs, and then the information that's available privately, where you have to create a partnership with another company. So for example, Christie's just did a sale last month that was blockchain-enabled by Artery. They now have a registry of all of those works of art that's available in the blockchain that we can then link to with our data. So if one of those works that sold at Christie's last month is registered to our platform, we can link to the URL of that sale record and we can start creating a checking system of that being true. Same with Artsy, and then we have a central vocabulary that we take care of that's about the museums. So who are the museums? Is this really a museum? And can we then ask a museum user to authenticate that exhibition history of that object? So that ties really nicely into this trusted data sources issue. You need to identify the players within your industry who are doing the checks and balances of the data to be able to verify what you're doing. So in the art world, I'm going to use this record again as an example. You have these different supply chain, what I was calling supply chain information bits about the artwork. And if you look deeper, there are all these different names of entities within our data that we're starting to identify and dig out. So we're mining and finding Sotheby's, Christie's, the Ruskin Gallery, etc. And we'll have varying levels of trust in that entity as a source in the supply chain. So if it's something that comes with a multi-party agreement, i.e. an insurer can confirm that that work was insured when it was at that museum, or a shipper can confirm that it moved that artwork when it was sold at Sotheby's, then it starts being a more verified transaction. If it's only something that is in plain text within our database, it's less trusted. But basically, this starts getting really interesting because we're facilitating new contracts of new people that are starting to borrow these works. So we're creating new nodes or systems on that supply chain to check that so this museum really borrowed this in 2020 from this collector. So those bits of metadata start being very verified, and then we can have a lot of different entities, the insurer, the shipper, the conservator at the museum, confirming the information about that artwork. So that starts getting really exciting, and you'll have, as I said, different levels of trust in that information. Of course, if it comes with a Word document, maybe you'll trust it a little bit less than if it's a PDF that's timestamped, or if you have something that's been made immutable. So basically, you start testing your data sources and testing the type of data they're giving you to verify how much you can really authenticate that information. And then the last bit, and the reason it's in a dotted line is because this is really cool, but also very much starting from the very basic, kind of related to the last presentation where they were talking about how do you know that really is that passport or that really is that thing, same thing. You can have a very beautiful provenance history of a work of art, digitally saved and accessible with multi-party agreements, everything, but then you can just switch the artwork, right? You can suddenly have a different artwork. And fraud is a problem in the art world. You do have a lot of times that they find out a painting is fake. For example, we know a collector in Brazil that had a very important artwork, super clear provenance. At some point, someone switched it. And the real one sold in New York a few months ago, and their one, they realized when they did some forensic analysis, it's not the real one. And because it happened so long ago and they're not sure when, it's very hard to prove that they are the real owner and that it's wrong. So we need to figure out how do you protect against that switcheroo. And so what's really cool is there are a few different techniques, and I'm going to start using a lot of buzzwords. The first is AI. So from a more zoomed out perspective, you can start identifying trends within a specific artist's work. And for example, this is a search for all the ears in Van Eyck's paintings. And you can analyze whether that ear is consistent with the way that Van Eyck would have painted an ear. That's one way that's happening. It's really helpful also, for example, for signatures, that you can look at the signature and then identify if that signature is sort of consistent with the different signatures that are available. And then, I don't know what this slide was about, but this is another really cool example that's using artificial intelligence. Late Rembrandt's work is very popular, and there's a lot of data on there. Particularly, there's a lot of spectral imaging, which basically means that you can see what the elements are within the painting using its radiance and all of these different things. So you can see how much tin is in this painting, how much magnesium, etc. And they've identified in his late works how he paints these paintings. So he tends to have this element in his white and this element in his black and all of these different types of rules of how he worked. And the AI has gotten smart enough that they asked the computer to repaint this from a black and white image based on the spectral information about the pigments. And it was practically the same painting. The computer was able to identify the colors correctly, and that is because it knows if you find some of the pigment that was white and some of the pigment that was red, Rembrandt didn't use to mix them to make pink. He usually did a white wash with a red glaze or a bit of red with a white on top. And he's basically the computer is starting to get to know how Rembrandt painted and can then make it look like it. The only thing when they redid it was that suddenly her face had some black spots on it. You don't see black spots here. This is a completely clean face. Why did the computer, the AI, create some kind of strange black acne on her face? Turns out she had been conserved recently with a different type of paint. A lot of conservators do that so that you can identify where it's been restored. And that paint had the same elements as what Rembrandt's black usually is. So they basically could immediately identify the areas where it had been restored. This is really helpful if we have that type of information to then be able to identify the original artwork, because forging that type of depth of information is very difficult. So if we're thinking about humans, could we maybe do that for broken bones, etc.? Interesting thought. And the other thing that's starting to happen is paintings have crackler, which is the little cracks that happen within the painting over time. And these things are very difficult to predict. It's very difficult to know how a painting will crack or what's going to happen in terms of the wear and tear. And so what we are working with an organization to do is basically identify the points in the crackler, be able to perfectly figure out where that is. It's with a wonderful scientist in Canada who's working with us, and you can actually easily hash that type of information, because it's not that you're hashing the entire image, you're hashing the points of the crackler and the patterns in, for example, the wood grain of the back of the painting, and that's very difficult to identify. So if you have three paintings by the same artist, sometimes they use the same the same canvas for all three paintings, and you can identify where the lines of the painting have joined together and whether it's consistent with their technique. So this is really cool stuff that's starting to happen, that you can actually identify, and our cameras are getting good enough that you can take that type of a macro image and have the information about that artwork that would be very difficult to forge in terms of the information that in terms of the techniques that are available right now. So basically, the reason Isabelle thought this would be interesting to people who are working with authenticity is because you could very easily take it from art and think about humans. So what is the standard language that we use to talk about humans? Is it that we talk about height and weight and first name, last name? Can we create standardization of how that could happen? Could we create vocabularies of how the last names work around the world and whether there's some kind of consistency? Could we have a centralized or decentralized database of the identity documents? Those are the interesting ones. And then who are the trusted authorities that can give us information about the supply chain? Could it be universities? Could it be medical records, etc.? And as I was saying, it's not that one entity has all of this information. It's that you have a lot of different entities publishing their information and gathering it together. And then on the physical to digital, I thought it was quite interesting to think about whether we could potentially apply the same type of thing that we do with Crackler to the pigment, the way that our skin looks. Could there be some kind of a way of hashing our skin patterns into the documents that we're creating to attach the physical to digital? So those are a few of my ideas or what we're working on in London. I know it's very specific, but I hope it was kind of interesting to you guys. And just like art is valuable because it is unique and it has a story, humans are valuable because they are unique and they have their story. So how can we tell the stories of humans in a way that can then be authenticated in the future? Thanks.